Hello and welcome to C++ Weekly. I am your host, Jason Turner. I'm available for code reviews and on-site training. In this episode, we are going to pick up where we last left off in our upgrading code across the ages from pre-C++ 98 through C++ 17, and in this episode, moving in to C++ 20. Now, if you watched the last episode, one of the main things that we learned is that I have absolutely terrible error handling. And the more I've thought about this, the more I realize that this should probably be the first thing that we deal with as we're moving into C++ 20. Now, we really should have done this error handling back in C++ 98, but it didn't become very visible to me until I added fuzz testing. And the fuzz testing tested scenarios that I never considered, and many of those scenarios invoke undefined behavior. Let's see if we can just solve this in a very simple way so that we can at least get past some of these nominal fuzz test issues that we've got. And we're going to do that, I think, by replacing this assert with just simply a throw. This is going to be a checked pop now. And now on our fuzz tester, we'll put a try catch around this. And we can at least get a nominal test running here. We should be able to build and run our fuzz tester now out of memory error. That's interesting. The greatest common denominator is zero. So if we've got... All right, let's see what artifact caused this out of memory error. So we could have, by the way, investigated the artifacts here. Let's see where that went. There we go. So we've got this out of memory errors occurring on a zero size input. I wonder if it's just the fact that I'm running it from inside the debugger. Okay, so the undefined behavior sanitizer gave me an error, and running it inside the IDE's debugger, that was the problem here. But we get signed integer overflows, and it looks like it's actually generating plausible inputs. So it's really actually very interesting to look at the test corpus that is developed by your fuzz tester. There we go. Now we're getting lots of interesting outputs. So an important note here that I didn't realize is that you need to make sure that your library is linking with the fuzzer sanitizer as well. So that's something that I'm going to need to update in the boilerplate project. So you can see that it's actually generating relatively interesting inputs for our test here. Okay, so it looks like it generated a couple new crash outputs. Those came in just the last couple of minutes. And now we could run these and we could figure out what in the world kind of crash we were getting from them. Okay, so we have the fuzz tester properly working now. Let's go ahead and clean up our CMake. All right, so the point of this episode, and that's going to be 45 minutes of stuff to edit out, was to move to C++ 20 mode. So let's go ahead and start the move to C++ 20 mode. And right here, we are currently in C++ 17. We're going to move to C++ 20. Now, one of the main things that's going to happen when we move to C++ 20 is that we get to Constexpr the rest of the things. So this function uses a stack, and a stack is based on vector, and vector is Constexpr enabled in C++ 20. So I can take the stack and I can start doing this. And that's all it takes to make my stack type constexpr enabled. My rational number is already constexpr, and my string tokenizer is already constexpr. So the only thing left to make constexpr is the evaluator. And this might seem a little silly, but all we're gonna do is move this stuff into the header file. But we're gonna have one teeny tiny minor problem. Okay, it compiles, but we haven't actually added any constexpr test to this. And what we're going to find is that most of our tests simply just get moved into the constexpr part of this code. Okay, so here's the problem. From cars is not constexpr until C++ 23. All from cars does is take a string representation of an integer and make an integer out of it, right? So it really shouldn't be that hard for us to write our own version, right? Okay, there we go. I've got the IDE happy. I've got my test happy. And I am starting to move some of the runtime test into the constexpr test folder. Now recall that anything that happens in the constexpr test folder is also happening at both compile time and runtime. So we're not, you know, losing anything by doing this. We are gaining the fact that we can, in fact, evaluate all of these expressions at compile time if we are so inclined to do that. And at the moment, we don't have any runtime tests left, which means we also don't need the evaluator.cpp. Which means we don't actually have a library to compile anymore. This is a header-only library. It doesn't have any CPP files. So creating a header-only library is its own special kind of thing. We can just create it and as like a virtual library. It's similar to how we make our infizz warnings and such. And so these target link options, well, these were all private, so they're no longer meaningful. But the include directories do matter, and we're going to have to sort that out at some point. Okay, there's nothing left in here that's not constexpr. C++ 20 largely gave us more constexpr, and it also gave us concepts, which we are utilizing a little bit, to make sure that we are only parsing integral types. And it gave us ranges. And it gave us this thing called constEval. And with constEval, you can force a function to execute at compile time. And I have a use case for that. And we're going to try something that I haven't yet covered on this channel. So let's see how this goes. What we're going to do is look at a user-defined literal. And you can see that there's all these different user-defined literals for string view defined by our standard library. I'm going to attempt to do my own. Now, note this warning. User-defined literals not starting with an underscore are reserved by the implementation. So I'm going to do this. And I'm going to do this. This is going to be a rational number literal. And it's giving me a string and a len. So I should just be able to do this. Now, what I'm going to do is instead of making this const expr, I'm going to make it const eval. And by making it const eval, I'm going to require the compiler to evaluate my string literal at compile time, not at runtime. So let's see if we can do something useful with this in our test suite. And we can see, because these are all compile time tests, that the compiler let us know as we edited the code that this code will in fact compile and does the right thing. So now we can do compile time evaluation whenever we want to of rational numbers. And is there a good use case for this? I think there kind of is. Just as a, for example, this kind of thing, if I wanted 1/1,000,000th, it's difficult to represent exactly in floating point, but trivially easy to represent exactly with a rational number. And so why not? I can do this with a rational number at compile time and know that I have an exact representation of a particular value, and then perhaps use it in some way depending on the level of accuracy that I want at runtime, or perhaps even at compile time. So my rational number has this get float. Let's change the name of this. And we never even added test for this thing. We could do this and then have compile time constants that have perfect rational number representations, but we can get as any size floating point value that we wanted to get it as. It's interesting discussion, but the code has been simplified an awful lot in some ways and complicated in other ways, such as these no discard, const expr, or const no accept that's all over the place that wasn't there before. It does make me wonder if I should template the rational number type so that we can specify how large of integers we wanted to use to store these rational numbers, but we won't do that just now. Let's take a pass once more through this code and see if there's anything that we can do here. And I could have done this in C++ 17. I'd finally get that cleared up if you've been following along. So now I'm using in place to just return the in place back value instead of having to manually call dot back. And we don't need to necessarily specify our own operator equals equals here. Let's go ahead and let the compiler do it for us. And I'm going to do this with the three-way comparison operator, so operator spaceship. Just let the compiler do this for us. So that saves us some effort, and we have all the comparisons now. These things are sortable. All right, I think that wraps it up for this episode. Let's go ahead and get this committed. All right, so we constexpr'd the rest of the things. We used concepts where appropriate. I can probably almost certainly simplify the parser by using ranges. Ranged for loops might have been missed in a couple of places. And I simplified the output with using standard format, which is a C++ 20 feature. So the concept that I used or C++ 20, constexpr C++ 20 support that I used, and standard format is C++ 20. The UDL that I did, I could have done in C++ 11, but I made it const eval to a force compile time evaluation in C++ 20, which makes sense because it's a literal. So a literal must be known at compile time. Therefore, this could have been done at compile time. And we know that all of our tests run because they compile, and we know that they run without undefined behavior because they compile, and that's a lot of the beauty of constexpr for code like this. Now I'm planning to do a C++ 23 follow-up episode, in a moment here, and we'll see how that one goes. So thank you for watching this episode of C++ Weekly. I hope you enjoyed it. Be sure to subscribe.